by myself. At least, if there's anybody here that'll go with me. Anybody here that'll pray with me. Anybody here that'll sing with me. Anybody here that will walk with me. That's the one and the only that God has for us. I don't have to go by myself. But if I have to, y'all ain't here. Our scripture for today will be taken from the book of Genesis, chapter 42. We will begin with verse 1. Genesis chapter 42. We're going to begin with verses 1 through 5. But I want you to know we are going to cover a large tract of scriptures today. We're going to end up in Genesis chapter 46. But today, Genesis beginning right now, Genesis chapter 42, verses 1 through 5. While you're turning there, I want to say thank you to our praise team this morning. I tell you what, I could have listened to y'all sing another 30 minutes. But luckily, I had gotten most of my praise out on the way to church this morning. Anybody else do that? You praise on the way to church? Let me tell you, it makes service go a whole lot better if you already come prayed up and praised up. Amen. I want to thank our male chorus this morning. Gentlemen, you're doing a great job. I saw a brother or two out there in the audience that looked like they were going to have on some black ties. If you had on a black tie, this was your day. You could have come on up here. We wouldn't have given you a hard time. You could have come on up here. Genesis chapter 42, verses 1 through 5. Amen? Will you now rest on your feet for the reading of God's word? From the New King James Version of the Bible, the Word of God reads, when Jacob saw that there was grain in Egypt, Jacob said to his sons, why do you look at one another? And he said, indeed, I have heard that there is grain in Egypt. Go down to that place and buy for us there, that we may live and not die. So Joseph's 10 brothers went down to buy grain in Egypt. But Jacob did not send Joseph's brother Benjamin with his brothers, for he said, lest some calamity befall him. And the sons of Israel went to buy grain among those who journeyed, for the famine was in the land of Canaan. Let us pray. Father, thank you for the reading, hearing, and understanding of your word. Thank you, God, for the truth that is found in your word. And I want to thank you, Lord, for the encouragement that we glean from your word today. Father, teach us how to dream again. Help us to believe that you are the God that can do exceeding and abundantly above all that we may ask or think according to the power that works in us. As always, Father, I ask very humbly that you would allow your spirit to work through me for your glory, that this body of Christ will be edified, and you, Holy Father, will be glorified. Pick us up, God. Dust us off, God. And get us moving on our way. In Jesus' name. Amen. You may be seated in the presence of God. And we thank the ushers this morning for your service. And to our ushers in training, you're doing a great job. Today we're going to bring to a close what has been, for me personally, a very exciting series. We've been talking about prophetic dreams. And we understand that God calls his prophets dreamers of dreams. And he is speaking to us. He wasn't just speaking to them back then. God is still speaking to us today. Amen? So we are being encouraged through this series to believe that God can make us dream again. And we've been looking at dreams in the life of Joseph in the Old Testament, the son of Jacob. In the first week, we began by defining what a dream is and the difference between just a regular dream and a prophetic dream. And in that message, we encourage you, when we looked at the two dreams that Joseph had, we encourage you to find God. Find God in the dreams and examine yourself and also acknowledge others. In the second week, we saw that his brothers had turned against him and, And he was sold into slavery, but God was still with him. And even while he was in jail, Joseph was able to interpret the dreams of the butler and the baker of Pharaoh. And we learned that their dreams are very unique and very individual. It's your dream, but it's God's interpretation. And at the end of the day, what becomes of your dream is your reality. Amen?
Amen.
Last week, we saw how Joseph's dreams took a turn. You know, up until this point, it looked like everything was downhill in Joseph's life. He was, you know, rejected by his brothers, sold into slavery, and then from slavery to jail. But then now, in last week's message, we find him standing before Pharaoh, interpreting Pharaoh's dreams. And at the end, we find that Joseph is made second in command in Egypt. We would hear in America liken that to being vice president. If Pharaoh was president, Joseph was like vice president. And what we learned from that message is that we've got to keep the faith.
Amen.
We've got to keep the faith. We have to know our season. And I know I didn't share this with you last Sunday, and I thought about it on my way home. The reason why it's so important for you to know what season you are in and the seasons of your life is so that you know how to handle yourself in various seasons. Paul tells Timothy, he says, I know how to handle myself. I know how to be, he tells the church at Philippi, I know how to be exalted. I know how to be abased. I know how to be hungry. I know how to be full. In all ways and all things I am instructed by God, I can do all things through Christ who strengthens me. He's saying, I know how to handle myself regardless of what the circumstances may be. That's why we need to know what season we're in. When things are going bad, we got to still know how to be Christ-like in the bad times. And when things are going well, we got to know how to be Christ-like in the good times as well. Amen? So we got to keep the faith, know our season, and stay in the Spirit. Today, Joseph's dreams are being realized. And we're going to focus on what happens in his life during this time. So let me give you a little bit of introduction here. So Joseph's brothers resented him because he dreamed a dream where his sheaf of wheat, and those of you who don't know what a sheaf is what happens when they cut the wheat and they put it in bundles. So it's a standing bundle. His sheaf of wheat stood high and their sheaves bowed down to him. And then he also dreamed that, you know, the sun, the moon, and the 11 stars bowed down to him. And his brothers resented him for that. And they resented him also for being his father's favorite. So they decided to silence this dreamer. And they plotted against him. And they schemed. And they made preparations. And they wanted to kill him. But Reuben, the oldest, spoke up for him and said, don't kill him. So what they did was they put him down in a pit. They put Joseph down in a pit. And while he's down in the pit, they eat a meal and they're enjoying themselves. And lo, here comes a group of people, caravan on their way to Egypt, and they sell Joseph as a slave to go to Egypt. Not only did they sell him as a slave, but then they covered up the lie. They took his coat, they killed an animal, put the blood on the coat, went back to his father and said, he's been killed by a wild beast. Look, there's the blood on his coat. They went on living like nothing had ever happened. Joseph was between 15, most scholars say he was between 15 and 17 years old when this happened. Now in our text today, when we're reading about Joseph earlier, we find that Joseph is actually now 39 years old. How do we know he's 39? We know he's 39 because the Bible says he was 30 years old when he stood before Pharaoh. That was over in chapter 41. He has gone through the 7 years of abundance that the Lord said were coming to Pharaoh. And now he has been in the famine for 2 years. So by chapter 45, we find out that Joseph is now 39 years old. And if we assume that the scholars are right, that he was between 15 and 17 when he had those dreams, that would mean that it's been a minimum of at least 22 years from the time you dream to the time his dreams are being realized. That's more than 2 decades. Think about that for a minute. What has happened in your life in the last 2 decades? That's a long time, don't you think? 2 decades living in a foreign land. decades away from his family and being around people who spoke a foreign language. 2 decades of working as a slave and also as a house servant and spending time as an inmate. And even now, he is a servant to Pharaoh. Yeah. 2 decades that his brothers have been living a lie. 2 decades that they have been believing that they won. We got rid of this dreamer. He is gone. 2 decades of them telling Jacob, his father, that Joseph was dead, and them also telling themselves he must be dead by now. And now God is about to make all of Joseph's dreams come true. There are 3 truths I want to give you today that you need to know when God makes the prophetic dreams in your life come true. The first is, every knee must bow. Every knee must bow. Let's go to verse 6. It says, now Joseph was governor over the land, and it was he who sold to all the people of the land, and Joseph's brothers came and bowed down before him with their faces to the earth. Joseph saw his brothers and recognized them, but he acted as a stranger to them and spoke roughly to them. Then he said to them, where did you come from? And they said, from the land of Canaan to buy food. So Joseph recognized his brothers, but they did not recognize him. Then Joseph remembered the dreams which he had dreamed about them and said to them, you are spies. You have come to seek the nakedness of the land. And they said to him, no, my lord, but your servants have come to buy food. We are all one man's sons. We are honest men. Your servants are not spies. The Bible says that his brothers came to him and bowed down their faces to the ground. Think about this. Joseph dreamed about grain. He dreamed about sheaves of grain standing up and their sheaves bowing down to his sheaf. And here they are, 22 years later, needing some grain. And God has sent them to the only place that can get grain, to the only person who has grain. And he just happens to be their brother Joseph. And when they show up, the first thing they do is bow down. Tell your neighbor, every knee must bow. Let me talk a little bit about this. Just bear with me for a minute. Let me talk a little bit about some of the naysayers and some of the haters for the dream that God has in your life. Naysayers are those individuals that will talk your dream down. They may not do anything, but they always got something to say. And the answer is usually nay. I know we don't say nay very often in this country and in this language. But there are people who are always saying something negative about what you wanted to do. Why? Because they want to discourage you. Joseph's oldest brother, Reuben, was a naysayer. He spoke against Joseph's dreams just like all the rest of his brothers. But when it came time to act and they wanted to kill Joseph, he spoke up and he said, let's not kill him. All Reuben really wanted to do was to scare the boy. I just want to scare him. I want to let him know that he's not as big and high and mighty as he thinks he is. I'm going to say nay and let him know and put him in his place. That's what naysayers like to do. Naysayers are the ones who will hear about what God is doing in your life, throw a rock and hide their hand. And they really don't want to do anything to you, but what they're doing is every time they throw a rock and they hide their hand, they turn to somebody else and they go, ain't that right? And the moment they agree, you know what has happened? They gave them a rock too. And some of us don't realize there's some people in our lives who are spreading rocks behind our back. They always got something negative to say when somebody mentions your name. Well, they got something negative to say every time God is moving you forward. Every time you go higher, they go a little bit lower. And they continue to spread those rocks around so that the next time you step up to do something for God, oh, man. We don't agree with that. That's just what naysayers do. Haters, though, are different. Haters are When a person becomes a hater, they're really only one step away from doing something.
Yes, sir.
They're only one step away from doing evil toward you.
Yeah.
Let's look at some scripture. Let's go to Matthew chapter 5, verse 21 and 22. We'll look at the first part of 22. The scripture says, this is Jesus talking, the Sermon on the Mount. You have heard that it was said to those of old, you shall not murder. And whoever murders will be in danger of the judgment. But I say to you that whoever is angry with his brother without a cause shall be in danger of the judgment. Jesus is saying if that hatred is already in their heart, the only thing they need is the opportunity. They don't, you can't see their motive. Hello, how many of you know you can't see their motive? But it's in their heart, and when the opportunity arises, that's when they strike out against you. That's the difference between a naysayer and a hater. A naysayer is going to always open their mouth and say nay. A hater is going to wait till the right opportunity to try to tear you down.
Yeah.
That's what haters do.
Yeah.
If somebody, think about it, if somebody hates you with all their heart, all they need is the right opportunity to present itself for them to do something. Think about it. Somebody hits you on your job, all they need is the right opportunity to make things hard for you.
Yeah.
They never liked you in the first place, and when it came time for a new schedule, to come out there and mess your schedule up.
Amen.
They never liked you in the first place. You asked for a day off, and they couldn't give you a day off. They took a day off instead.
Yeah.
Because they got something on the inside of them that is contrary to what's going on with you. And when the opportunity presented itself, then they stepped up and did something. If they hate you and you're at school, all they're doing is waiting on the right opportunity when they can get the right group of people around to say something to make you look bad in front of everybody else. Because peer pressure is the thing that goes on in school. You know, you got those people who are just waiting for that opportunity, the right time, to say something negative about you. To hurt your credibility. It's somebody in your family. Don't you look at your family members. Here's the thing. Your family members might not do anything to you. What they will do instead is fail to do for you. The opportunity presents itself for them to be a blessing to bless you, and instead of them blessing you, they don't have the time. They can't help you. Every time they think about you, they think about how, you know, I'm going to leave that alone. Y'all work it out at home. Once the haters act, then you know who they are. The Bible says you will know them by their fruit.
Yeah.
After all this time, the haters and the naysayers are both right there bowing down at Joseph's feet. Somebody tell your neighbor, every knee must bow.
Every knee must bow.
Doesn't matter how bad they hate you, when God moves, every knee must bow. Doesn't matter how bad they talk about you, when God moves, every knee must bow. When God gives you a dream, there is no power in earth or in hell that can stop what God wants to do in your life. Every knee must bow. Every knee must bow, and God will make some of them bow. While they bow, they'll have to bless you. People who stole from you are going to have to turn around and give God some praise because of what he has done in your life. People who slandered your name are going to have to bow down and acknowledge the will of God in your life. People who have placed stumbling blocks in your path are going to be forced to bend down and move the stumbling block and turn them into stepping stones with you, because every knee must bow to him. Every knee must bow. People who try to hurt you, people who try to kill your dreams, people who try to put traps in your place are going to fall down in their own trap, because God has said something in your life, and when God's word moves, it will go out and accomplish whatever he has set forth for you to do. Every knee must bow. Don't worry about your naysayers and your haters. God's plan cannot be stopped. God's will cannot be hindered. And God's blessings cannot be taken away. Let me tell you some more of the story. So Joseph calls his brothers spies.
We skip on a few chapters. He calls them spies. He detains them and puts them in prison. He keeps Simeon in prison and sends the rest of them home and says, you can't come back and buy any more grain until you bring back Benjamin, your youngest brother. So they go back with the grain. Not only has he put them in a fix by saying they have to bring back Benjamin, but he put their money back in their sacks so it looks as if they stole the grain. He was forcing them to have to deal with him again. So they tried to wait it out, but the famine had not come to an end. So when the food ran out, they had to go back to Egypt, and they brought Benjamin back with them. And when they brought Benjamin back, they sat down to eat at Joseph's house, and then Joseph sent them away with all their grain, and he put his silver cup down in Benjamin's sack. And then after he put his silver cup down in Benjamin's sack, he sent the guards after them. He said, when you catch them, search the sacks and bring them back. They all are just a bunch of criminals. Let's go to the scriptures. This is going to make sense. Amen? Let's go to chapter 45, verse 1. I told you we're going to cover some scripture here. We're going to chapter 45, starting at verse 1. Amen? The Bible says, then Joseph could not restrain himself before all those who stood by him, and he cried out, make everyone go out from me. So no one stood with him while Joseph made himself known to his brothers. And he wept aloud, and the Egyptians and the house of Pharaoh heard it. Then Joseph said to his brothers, I am Joseph. Does my father still live? But his brothers could not answer him, for they were dismayed in his presence. And Joseph said to his brothers, please come near to me. So they came near. Then he said, I am Joseph, your brother, whom you sold into Egypt. I wanted to know, when I read this, why did Joseph put them through all this rigmarole? Why did he put them through all these changes and sending them back and making them come back? And what was the point of all the tricks that he was doing? I mean, God has blessed him. His dream has come to pass. They had bowed down before. Now what? And it just seems like Joseph was being, how do we say it? Joseph was being extra. Joseph was going above and beyond. And God revealed it to me. He says, well, the answer is Benjamin. Joseph went through all these changes with his brothers because he wanted to get Benjamin to stay with him. You see, Joseph had, I'm going to give you a little family history, okay? Jacob, Joseph's brother, he had 12 sons, but he didn't have one wife. He had two wives and 2 to 3 concubines. And what happened was he worked for his father-in-law for 7 years so that he could marry this woman named Rachel that he really loved. Yeah. But on his wedding day, the father tricked him and gave him Rachel's older sister, Leah, and said, well, I can't let the older one stay here, the younger one get married before the older. But Jacob loved Rachel so much, he stayed and worked another 7 years so that he could be with Rachel. Once he got Rachel, Leah was already having children and was gloating and saying, look at all the kids I got. But Rachel was barren and could not have children. So Rachel said, look, take my handmaid and have some children by her. That way I have some children through my handmaid. Well, Leah saw that. She said, well, you take my handmaid and you have some babies. And at the end of the day, he ended up with 12 kids because eventually Rachel did have a son named Joseph. And then she had one more son named Benjamin, and she died giving birth to Benjamin. Joseph was the son from the wife that he loved deeply. Benjamin was Joseph's little brother. I know he's got Reuben and Simeon and Judah and Dan and all Gad and all the rest of the brothers, but it was something special about Benjamin in the eyes of Joseph. So, they were the youngest. They were precious to their father. They were precious to each other. And Joseph just wanted to do anything in his power to get Benjamin to stay with him. He told them, you can't come back unless you find Benjamin.
You can go away, but I'm going to make it so that you still got to bring Benjamin right back to me.
Yes.
Let me tell you something. Even though Joseph had his own inferior dream, not the dream God had given him, this is something that he wanted personally. God would not let it come to pass. And Joseph was forced to confess. Let me tell you something. When God blesses you, it's for a reason. And it's his reason. When God makes your dreams come true, it's for a purpose. It's his purpose. When God opens doors for you, it is a part of his plan for your life. When God delivers you, it's for his glory. When God raises you up, you need to remember that it is God who is still in control. Because God is not going to allow you to get out of line with the purpose that he has instilled for your life. Tell your neighbor, every tongue must confess. Even if it's yours. Even if it's yours. You have to get in line with God. Let me go a little bit deeper. Let's go to verse 5. Verse 5, but now do not therefore be grieved or angry with yourselves because you sold me here. For God sent me before you to preserve life. For these 2 years the famine has been in the land, and there are still 5 years in which there will be neither plowing nor harvesting. And God sent me before you to preserve a posterity for you in the earth and to save your lives by a great deliverance. So now, it is not you who sent me here, but God. And he has made me a father to Pharaoh and lord of all his house and a ruler throughout all the land of Egypt. Joseph is put in a situation by God where he realizes, wait a minute, hold on, even if I send them back without Benjamin, they got to come back anyway. Because the famine is not over. It's only been 2 years. God said there'll be 7 years of famine. I'm in a situation where I have to pause right now and recognize I wasn't just sitting here so that I could see them bowing in front of me. I wasn't given those dreams just so that I could see them bowing in front of me. I was given those dreams so that I could come to this place and recognize what God was doing, because God sent me down here so that I could save all of them. God sent me here so that I could save my family. God sent me here so that I could make a way for them to still survive even in all of the famine that was going on. He was forced to realize that God was still in control. Though he had his own agenda and his own plans, he couldn't turn and go some other direction. He couldn't turn his back on God. He couldn't use God to get what he wanted. Did you hear that? He couldn't use God to just get what he wanted. He tried every way he could. Let me tell you something. We need to be careful when our dreams come true. We need to be careful not to get beside ourselves. And we need to remember where our blessings come from. When God fulfills his promise to you, do not forget about God. Don't just get to the moment where you arrive in the place that God is taking you, and then you say to yourself, well, I can handle it from here. Thank you, God, for getting me here, but now I've got my own agenda. No, you need to confess that God is still the one on the throne. When God brings you to the doorstep of the purpose he has in your life, don't forget about God. When God makes your dreams a reality, don't forget about God. Don't lower your standards. Don't get out of the spirit. Don't become self-centered. Don't become vengeful against all the people who gave you a hard time. Don't become spiteful. Don't start bragging and get prideful in your mind. Don't lord it over everybody else. See, I told you so. Why? Because every tongue must confess. Even yours. Instead, stay home. Stay home and confess that you didn't get here by yourself. Stay humble and stay faithful and confess that it was nothing but God that kept you because you wanted to turn around and go back the other way. Stay committed and realize and confess there were some times I wanted to give up.
Stay spiritual and confess. The devil sometimes you just came to church and you were waiting on God to show up and you didn't feel like praising him and you just sat there. Confess it, believe it, and know that even though you have gone through your ups and your downs, it was nobody but the Lord that brought you to the place where you are now. Stay generous and stay prayerful, because there are some of us who don't realize it was nothing but prayer that brought us through. Why? Because his thoughts are higher than our thoughts. His ways are higher than our ways. And we have to acknowledge God in everything that we do. Every tongue must confess. Lastly, let's go to chapter 46, verse 1. And I want to tell you that every dream I must dream. Every dream I must dream. Beginning with verse 1, we'll do verses 1 through 4. The scripture says, so Israel, talking about Jacob, so Israel took his journey with all that he had and came to Beersheba and offered sacrifices to the God of his father Isaac. Then God spoke to Israel in the visions of the night and said, Jacob, Jacob. And he said, here I am. So he said, I am God, the God of your father. Do not fear to go down to Egypt, for I will make of you a great nation there. I will go down with you to Egypt, and I will also surely bring you up again. And Joseph will put his hand on your eyes. Pharaoh heard about Joseph's family. Pharaoh sent carts and chariots. He said, go pick up your folks and go bring them all. Go grab everything they got. In fact, you can even leave their stuff. We'll give you the best of everything that's in Egypt. You just go and go get them. Send a cart. So Jacob is on a cart, and Jacob is riding, and he's on his way to Egypt to see his brother, his son that he thought was dead. And in the middle of the night, something special happened. Jacob, the dream. Think about that for a minute. Joseph's dreams have come to pass. Jacob has heard about what God has done for Joseph. And then all of a sudden, Jacob dreams again. Oh, what's the big deal, Reverend? Well, you gotta realize Jacob was a dreamer. Jacob dreamed on his way to go find a wife, and he saw a ladder going up to heaven. We call it Jacob's ladder. He dreamed again when he was on his way back home with his wife, and God, he wrestled with a man all night long, and he put his hip out of socket, and because of that, he is called Israel, because he has strength with God. He dreamed on a regular basis. He had that kind of a connection with God. But while his son was going through, he was just living out his life. But when he found out about his son's dreams coming true, he's on his way to see it, and God speaks to him. Jacob dreamed again.
Yeah.
All right. What's the big deal, Reverend?
Understand that when your dreams come true, don't be surprised if other people around you start dreaming. Don't be surprised. Because the truth is, some of us are afraid to dream these big, audacious dreams. Some of us are afraid to trust God like that. You know, we trust God about this far. We don't trust him all the way. And we're watching you because you said that God is going to do something great in your life. And when you finally get there, then some of us are going to say, well, if he did it for her, I know he can do it for me. If he did it for him, I know he can do it for me. And we might begin to try to dream when we've never dreamed before. Why? Because we're watching you. We're hearing you. We may not be saying anything, but we believe that the same God that blessed you can bless us also. We believe that the same God who does the impossible for you can do the impossible for us also. So we're wanting, we're hoping, we're praying that somehow, some way, God will perform everything that you said he's going to perform in your life. Everything that God has revealed to you. We're your champions. We're behind you. And we're praying with you. We may not say much. It's because we're watching to see. There's some folks in this church who have overcome cancer. because of their testimony. Because they prayed and they said, I know that the Lord is going to heal me. And because I've seen them heal, I know that God can do the same for me if it becomes a part of my life. That's just an example. There are folks here who have had God bless them with houses and cars and opportunities and promotions and jobs. And God is speaking to them, but we're watching them, and we're going to have to start believing that He can do the same for us, that we can begin to dream just like they were dreaming. Down the street, Mount Olive, every time I pass by Mount Olive Baptist Church, they're building a new church. It's almost done. In fact, it's done. The dedication is coming up soon. I'm looking at this church, and every time I pass by, you know what I say to myself? I say, thank you, God.
That's right.
Because now I know it can be done.
Yeah.
There are folks who have said it can't be done in Tuskegee. There are folks who say it's always going to be the way it's always been. Nothing new is going to happen. Listen, let me tell you, I drive by it every day. Every time I come to church, I see it can be done. Your dream that God has for you is a part of a bigger picture. There are others watching you. Joseph had all these great things happen to him, but do you realize Joseph's dream was just a footnote in Jacob's? When we talk about God, we talk about the God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. Nobody says Joseph. It's because God spoke to Jacob and said, I will make you a great nation. He spoke to Isaac and said, I will make you a great nation. He spoke to Abraham and he said, out of your seed, all the nations of the world will be blessed. All of these people saw visions and had dreams of God, and God began to make it happen. And along the way, he had to get one more dreamer named Joseph to put things in order. Why? Because all the way back in the Garden of Eden, God spoke a word to Adam and Eve. You've fallen from grace. I'm casting you out of the garden. But you need to know this. There's going to come a day when your seed shall bruise his heel, but he will crush the serpent's head. God had a plan that started way back at creation. And it came through Abraham, and it came through Isaac, and it came through Jacob, and it came through Joseph, that God was about to send a Savior into all of the world. That this Savior was going to be after the order of Melchizedek. He's going to be both a priest and a king. That this Savior was going to be the Passover lamb that was slain so that the firstborn in Egypt would be killed and the firstborn of those in Israel would be spared. That this same Savior, we see him in the scriptures as a rock that gives them water in the middle of the wilderness. A rock that gave out water. We're talking about a Savior who is represented in the Ark of the Covenant, where he carries within him all the blessing of God. We're talking about the kinsman redeemer. We're talking about the one that is going to sit on the everlasting throne of the covenant that he made with David. We're talking about this vision that Isaiah saw when he said, I saw it. I know that other people didn't see it, but I saw it high and lifted up, and the angels went all around him crying, holy, holy, holy. We're talking about this vision, this dream, this purpose that God had even from creation. You don't believe it. It's Mary's baby. It's Jesus. He is the bread of life. It is Jesus. He is the living water. It is Jesus. He is the rock in a weary land. It is Jesus, the Lamb that was slain for the foundation of the world. It is Jesus, the author and the finisher of our faith. It is Jesus, the Lion of the tribe of Judah. It is Jesus, who is the Alpha and the Omega. He is the beginning and the end. He is the King of Kings, and He is Lord of Lords. He is the reason why we dream. He is the reason why the doors are always open to us. He is the reason why we are able to go forward. Be afraid to dream again. It's not too late. You're not too old. You haven't. Your best days are not behind you, because God is still God. And He is alive and not dead. And if you are alive, then He can quicken you so that you can still do His will. Well, Reverend, I don't have enough education. Don't worry. Joseph didn't have any. Well, I don't have enough money to make my... Joseph didn't have any money. Well, I don't have enough people to support me. You know, nobody's on my side. Joseph was by himself. All he had was God on his side. And through slavery, rejection from his brothers, being falsely accused by Potiphar's wife, being cast into prison, being forgotten by the baker and the butler, even down to the time that he worked for Pharaoh and started going through a famine, he still had his dream. And because of that, God made it come to pass. Doesn't matter if this is a year, 2 years, or like in Joseph's circumstance, 22 years. Some of us are going to have to realize we got to wait on God. Don't let go. Just wait on God. Don't give up. Just wait on God. Don't say it'll never happen. Just keep pressing. If God said it, you got to believe it. And that's not settled. You got to let God do the God part. You just do your part. But just stay faithful. Stay humble. Stay prayerful. Because if God gave it to you, there's nothing in the world that can stop it. We serve God that can do exceedingly abundantly above all that we may ask or think. Even for the things that look impossible in your dreams, they're still not too big for God. God bless you.